Good morning, everybody. Let's get everybody out there in here, and let's all get seated, and let's get started. And I know there'll be others joining us as they get out of bed. Yeah, it's Saturday. What are we going to say? So welcome, welcome, welcome to CATS. Here we are for a great day. Amen. And so welcome to everybody. We're improvising a little bit because our MCs aren't here yet, but I want my honey to come up. And if anybody's out there, would you encourage them to come on in so we can get everybody here and get started? And maybe we could all kind of get to this center area here. Would really
Let's
help us.
Together.
Yeah, we're united. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Is anybody excited at all?
Yes.
Amen. All right. That's a little more like it. Well, we're just going to greet you and just open up here and get things underway. And I know there will be others coming, but do you want to say something?
Yes, I want to say something. Aren't we excited about the kingdom of God? Amen. And if you're here, it's because there's a hunger to hear and to seek more of the kingdom. The kingdom is going to reveal so many things to us that we didn't know before. And I think that's one of the hardest parts, because we're so used to what religion is, especially in the United States. Man, I came here 50 years ago, almost.
Wow.
Yeah, I guess so. 50 years ago, right before we got married.
Yeah.
We were engaged, and then I had to go back to Mexico, and that was that was hard, but I remember seeing a lot of what I didn't see in Mexico in religion. And that's a good thing. You know what? When we speak of religion, it's of that spirit that tries to stop and be against the kingdom, not about Christians and people that believe in Jesus. And it's a very complicated thing, because Jesus had that same problem with the religious people all their time. They were more political than they were believers in Christ.
Yeah.
So that's how you know the difference, by the way.
Yeah.
It's one of the reasons. So my heart just hurts a little bit because Apostle Chris and Jill are not here today. And I don't know, but there's an emptiness, right? And he was supposed to be preaching too. She's part of the panel and everything, and I don't know, he's kind of the glue that holds everything together, right? The super glue, I would say. And you know, when we came here, I mean, we super glued. What do you call it when you bind with somebody?
You connect.
But you're bound together,
right?
Like a chain together.
Yes.
Do you want to be chained together with me?
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
Because we're in Christ.
Amen.
And that's why that bond, it's strong. And we feel the absence of somebody when they're not here. And we hurt a little bit. And that is normal. And we are all members of the body of Christ. And when one member hurts, we all hurt. So we know that they're going to be well. They're resting. They've been through a lot. I mean, since we got this building, I didn't really do anything to get it. you didn't either.
No.
It was God, wasn't it?
Yeah.
And since then, there's been so much activity. And, you know, your leaders are the ones that, you know, get used up the most. And you're many leaders here too, not just them. But we miss them today, and we just pray in the name of Jesus that they'll be totally healed.
Amen.
Restored, and back to health, strong and vibrant for Jesus. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, honey. Amen. Well, let's just stand together. Our MCs are running late, but we want to kind of start off just with getting our motor going. So there's something that I want you to do with me, because this is an embassy meeting.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
You are ambassadors. We are not an audience. We are participants. So we're going to have a lot going on today, and once people really begin to get in here, we're going to really see what God has. This is a purpose on purpose for purpose. And so we're believing that you're going to go out of here with a fresh new level of assignment. Including those online that couldn't be here in person. So I want you to do something with me. See if I can get the pipes going early in the morning. Hail Jesus, you're my King.
Hail Jesus, you're my King.
Your love makes me to sing.
Your love makes me to sing.
I will praise you all my days.
I will praise you all my days.
You're perfect in all your ways. Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
How powerful you are.
How powerful you are.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
Hail, hail, Lion of Judah.
How powerful you are.
How powerful you are.
How powerful you are. Oh, come on, let's give him a hand. Amen. Praise. Amen. Amen. Well, you may be seated. And we're going to start things off with, again, just adjusting a little bit, but we're going to start things off with a kingdom conversation. Now, that would have been Apostle Chris, myself, and Doc. But since Apostle Chris is resting up, and he just hated to have to miss, but we said, hey, we want you in good shape. Amen. So now you're stuck with just me and Doc. And a few other little surprises. So Doc, would you come up? We're going to have a kingdom conversation. And you know these are unscripted, but we're hoping to begin to kind of set the tone of what we're believing God for today. Anybody prepared to be like in a serious meeting for the entire day? A serious, joyful meeting. Amen. So do we have a mic for Doc? Okay. Nope, we're going to stand up. Hey, I'm in good as shape as him.
I thought we was going to sit down.
Oh, well, I don't know if we can got the camera for that. But anyway, so say something in greeting.
Greetings.
Hey, oh, this your, oh, you got another mic. Hi, how's everybody? Okay, good. I need y'all to wake up for real. That was... Y'all didn't do Hail Jesus, You're My King, no justice, really. It's kind of, I know some of y'all can sing. I'm not going to say what I'm thinking about right now. I'm going to stay holy. So look, I just want to say thank you again just for the opportunity. The light is blinding me, for real. I just want to say, so if I'm looking down, I'm trying to see, because I got big eyes, so I need to focus. But I thank God for being here, also for my spiritual father and mother, Dr. Rick, Mother Liz. I thank God just for the opportunity. Thank God for our church members that are here, Stephanie and Astrid. We thank God for them. So, you know, we're international now, for real. Virtual is a monkey, so I'm like savoir faire. I'm everywhere, but that's good. That's good. That's good. So I'm grateful to be here. I don't know what's getting ready to happen.
I don't either.
I'm set up. Apostle Chris is in here. He can answer all the questions, him and Dr. Rick. So now I'm on the spot. So you waving, what that mean? Hey, he's talking to you.
Hello?
See, they do that to me at the church at home, and I'm like, I can't, I don't know. That all.
I have no idea.
Yeah, just come and tell us what you need, bro. Oh, he said you're good now.
I'm good now. Okay.
Yeah, I don't have a clue.
All right.
So look, my greetings is up. I'm going to let them do what they
so
do.
So what are we wanting to see out of this? I mean, we're not just coming to another church meeting or feel-good time, but we really want to know, when we talk about glory-to-glory kingdom renovation, and the advance, what does that mean to
you? Well,
you
sure set me up, aren't you?
Yeah.
You know, it's funny. So I can't get on my message, but I'm going to try my best not to. There's a different meaning for glory.
Yeah. Get ready to take some notes.
So most people look at glory as being the weightiness of God. You know I'm going to go on my notes, right?
Mm-hmm.
Glory, most people teach that the glory means the weightiness of God, but that's Old Testament. In the New Testament, glory means reflection. You have to be reflecting something. Mm-hmm. And one of the issues with the church is we're not reflecting God. We're not even reflecting kingdom. We're reflecting religion. We're reflecting what my grandmama and my great-grandmama and my granddaddy taught me. We're not reflecting the truth. We're reflecting Episcopalianism, Catholicism, Baptist, Mormon. We're
just
reflecting
the boom early.
Yeah, just drop it like it's hot. We're really not reflecting God.
Yeah.
And one of the problems with the kingdom is the fact that we're not reflecting. We're mirroring something that is not of God. We're mirroring something that we've been taught. We're mirroring our past hurts, inadequacies, inconsistencies. Yeah. We're mirroring the world. And so instead of us changing the world, we're adapting to the things of the world without reflecting the things of God.
Yeah.
We have an issue with being different. Yes. I've been different for 62 years. And right now, frankly, my dear, I don't care how you feel about me. Because I cannot be what you want me to be and still do what God called me to do.
Yeah.
It's of a necessity. I am who I am, regardless of whether you like the way it comes or not. So we've tried to condense. I don't know why you got me started. We're trying to condense ourselves inside of a world that we're really not a part of.
Mm-hmm.
And we fail to realize Jesus said, I'm not here to have mother love daughter. I'm not here to let father love son. I'm here to bring a division.
Yes, yes.
And for us to necessitate the glory of God, there's going to be some division in our families. I didn't expect. You know, I'm going to say this and shut up.
No, you're doing good.
The wildest thing that happened to me was my mother became a member of my church. Now, my mother knows me as Tony. You got to know me real close to call me Tony. I had a preacher one time say, well, me and Tony go way back, and my whole church got mad because they knew he only knew me for 2 weeks. You don't call me Tony. You don't know me, Tony. I'm sorry. Don't get upset. You haven't drank enough Jack and Coke with me. You haven't snorted enough Coke with me. You haven't smoked enough weed with me. You don't know me. You haven't shot marbles. I know y'all holy. You don't know Tony.
This was before.
Before Christ.
Yeah, okay, yeah, I just wanted to clear that up.
Yeah. No more medicinal purposes.
Just wanted to clear that up.
Yeah, it is. Yeah, this is
because I ain't snorted no coke with you either.
Yeah, but you're my father though.
That's right. That's right.
Hold on. You can do that. See, but everybody has it. But I'm just saying. So what happens is we try to acclimate ourselves and associate ourselves with people who are yet disassociated with what we consider to be kingdom. And so instead of reflecting God, we're reflecting or mirroring our past. We're mirroring our associates because we want to be engrafted with them. My friends don't know me.
Mm.
Not my high school friends, not my earthly acquaintances. They don't know me. I deal with very few pastors other than my father, Apostle Chris. Very few because we're not reflecting the same thing. You're still mirroring what you consider the gospel. But I have to reflect what I know is kingdom. And if I reflect kingdom, that means you're not going to always agree with me. You know, like them Easter people. I don't celebrate Easter. I celebrate Passover. Easter egg, Easter bunny ain't got nothing to do with a brother. But now what is the church doing? I hope I ain't stepping on no toes.
Oh, I'm sure
the people,
you are.
You say you should. I mean, the people that call themselves the church, why are we still doing something that the world is doing, knowing that it's not kingdom? Just to appease somebody's flesh. I've never liked to appease. I have to teach truth. I understand the division between Easter and Passover. So most people say, what does it have to do with kingdom? Well, it has a lot to do with kingdom because you're not teaching what Jesus taught.
Mm-hmm.
You're doing things to appease your constituents that are paying you a tithe and an offering.
Yeah.
I don't need to appease you for God to help me build his kingdom, because he stipulated that if I give, he'll cause men to give back to my bosom. I'm sorry.
So we could say
you can.
That the Passover caused us to move over.
You go ahead and hold your
because the glory of the Lord is prophetic.
Right. itself.
It's not the glory we feel
right
in a present circumstance to salve us or make us feel better about our current circumstance, but it speaks to what's coming.
Right.
That God has already called done.
Done deal.
So we can't be, what'd you say, mirroring the past. We have to reflect the future.
Reflect the future. My man. High five. Boom.
By the way, I want to say, Lady Jill is here. Right back there. Do you want to come and greet everybody? Would you come and greet everybody?
See, you know he's going to set you up.
Yeah. She tried to hide, but I have eyes everywhere. Come on, let's give her a big greeting. Amen. We appreciate them hosting this. Amen.
Well, it's our honor to host this today. We love you guys. We believe in what you do, and we want to be a part of everything that you're doing for the kingdom, as you are a part of everything we're doing for the kingdom together. So welcome, everybody. Have a great day, and receive whatever the Holy Spirit has for each one of you. Take it home, make a difference with it. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Amen. Amen.
You cheated.
Amen. She represents the apostle very well. Amen. Amen. So we want you to know the sincerity of our passion, and that is that you carry away something that God has revealed to you. This Glory to Glory conference, we're calling it the Renovative Advance. Things are not going to be the same. But they're not going to change the way the world says they're going to change. No virus ever eternally changes things. It comes and goes. And I would rather it just keep going. But your purpose is never put on pause.
No.
But I'm telling you that I really believe, and I'd like to get your thought on this. I really believe that the glory of the Lord, I mean, for him, it's always consistently the same. But the glory of the Lord is going to increase on your life. Come on, somebody. And that's going to cause a mantle to come up and through you that you didn't know was there. And so this is why I really believe God timed this seminar for a springtime. Because you're getting ready to move in, not because of a calendar, but you're getting ready to move into a greater dimension of the glory of the Lord that is not going to be familiar to a lot of us. Because it's going to take on a shape that you didn't think it was going to take. What do you think?
Yeah. You know, when I got the invitation to speak, and I was reading, you know, I felt like you set me up, but I was reading because I was trying to figure this out. Because when I did my conference in December, my theme was what? You know, like, what's next? What is the next move? What is God directing us to do? After you've done all to stand, what? So you use the terminology renovate, which means to renew. Mm-hmm. So something that has been dormant, you see, I like that right there. Something that has been dormant has to get to a place to where it renews itself to become alive, a seed. So I'm going to use the calendar. A seed is buried in the wintertime, and it dies. The Bible says, unless that seed dies, it can't bring forth fruit.
That's right.
Now, the funny thing you said about the picture or coming out different, we see the picture of the tomato plant on the seed bag. But we do not see the tomato plant in the seed. All we see is a seed. And if you break that seed open, all you're going to get is dust. So in essence, in us, God has planted this seed.
Wait, can you say that again? When you break open a seed,
it's dust.
It doesn't accomplish its purpose.
Mm-mm.
And it becomes dust. Isn't it interesting? It becomes dust.
Yeah.
Wow. Go ahead.
I know that's gone right there.
I'm getting chill bumps.
So, but it,
glory
it,
chill bumps.
It really does. So when you said that, we become something that we did not know we were.
Mm-hmm.
But I look at the way how God draws one another together, draws us together as one.
Mm-hmm.
to promote something that has been lying dormant in us that has to be revealed so we can come into our true selves.
Yeah.
To become something that we never saw before. God.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Because it's kind of like, I sure didn't want to get emotional. I deal with my childhood. In my childhood, I always talk trash. But very few people, I had an issue a couple of weeks ago. My wife's like, are you going to be okay? I said, I don't know. I don't know what's going on. There are very few people in my childhood know the real me. They know my nicknames, PT, Mr. Profile, Little Fox. They know that. They don't know Tony. They never knew what I knew. And so within that, everybody was always going against me. I know somebody know what I'm saying. They were always against me. They never understood me. They never wanted to be around me. They always put me down. But there was some dust.
Yeah.
Inside of me. See, I messed up when I turned 14, 15, 16 and running the streets. I found out my middle name was Emmanuel.
Yeah.
And I knew that Emmanuel meant God is with me. So there was times that I drank two or three, four, five fifths of MD-2020 and I'm driving and I'm going to sleep and I'm on the other side of the bridge and don't know how I got on the other side of the bridge, but it was because of the dust.
Yeah, yeah.
That was in me because he had another purpose.
Yeah.
That I could not see.
So the purpose is in the dust, but the dust is not the purpose.
Right. Right. The purpose of the dust.
Why do we keep referring to each other by our skin color? Not you and me, but I mean.
Well, you know. See,
why do we do that?
See, I see you. The funny part is all of this skin color is in God.
Yeah, it is.
And so what we don't see is we don't see the true reflection of God in us. We see the dust that man calls racism.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because man tries to separate the dust so that the dust don't promote what God created.
Yeah.
So instead of looking at what he created, we start looking at the inadequacies that's in us and reflecting that mirror on somebody else because we realize we haven't grown yet.
Yeah. Wow.
It's just
crazy. Well, you know, when Liz and I got married.
Y'all had issues.
50 years ago, she didn't know very much English. I thought she was quiet. And I found out I married.
I say you had issues because of ethnicity.
Yeah. Now you're trying to clean it up.
No, I'm sorry. I didn't mean ethnicity.
I know. But when we got married, I knew she was from Mexico, and I understood that, but I didn't marry her because she was from Mexico.
Right, right.
I married her because I fell in love with her. And so once we were in a service, and a person came up to me and says, how does it feel to be in an interracial marriage?
Ooh.
And I said, me? I never thought of it.
Right.
And another guy came up and says, how does it feel to be in an international marriage? I thought, I like that one better. But people tend to look at the outward dust instead of the promise and the purpose that's on the inside. That once it's planted, even though it looks like it died, it will produce.
Yeah. See, now that
isn't that glory?
Well, see, not only is that glory, see, you don't went, that's too deep.
No, go ahead.
That's really. I'm going to do this racial dust side and leave it alone. Because there's still issues. I'm not African American. There's still issues in the black church. Because a black church racially will come and sit up on a white pastor. But a white person will not come and sit up on a black pastor. They'll fellowship and call one another friends, but they're not going to come in. They'll love the worship, but they're not going to come in. So then I take issue because my great-grandfather's Italian. And I take issue because I'm like, I never saw you as a color. I never saw you as an ethnicity.
Mm-hmm.
I saw you as a child of God. Yeah. I saw you as the dust that God has something greater inside of.
Amen.
But you looked at me as being a black man.
Mm.
You judged me but it goes the same way.
Mm-hmm.
Because black people are judge. I hate saying that, but you started this.
Yeah.
Black people would judge white people by saying, well, you think you're better than me. What? No, that's trailer trash. You know, they can't. you know, that's Rocco around the corner that's all tatted up, you know. Rocco,
wait,
you know.
Wait, what'd you say?
Rocco.
Rocco around the corner?
Yeah. That's way
is
from
that, is that's that out of Indiana. Is that what you call trash?
Well, when you know, now you want to know about trailer trash.
I'm trying as a white man to understand your ethnicity.
Well, see, here's what's funny. So you have, you know where the word ghetto come from?
No, I'm a white guy.
Ghettos is Jewish.
Ah.
Ghetto is a Jewish terminology because what the Jews would do, they would literally build houses on top of houses. Mm-hmm. So when the son is getting ready to get married, he would build a place next to his father's place. And the first year, they don't do anything but get prepared to have children. But if a relative comes, they build on top of that because all the houses are flat. Mm. And in order to get to that next level, they had ladders outside. Hence, it was called ghetto. Mm. So what they did was gave that terminology to black people that lived in apartment complexes.
Okay.
So it came from an apartment complex in the neighborhood to the ghetto. It's the same neighborhood, but they gave it the terminology ghetto. And instead of giving it the chew dust of being the inheritance of the father, they made it look negative because it's us.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Now they call it the ghetto.
And you know, of course, I'm just being facetious when I say I'm a white guy because
I
don't really know inside because I don't judge anybody by the flesh.
Right.
At least we're not supposed to. But... sometimes when you have to keep reminding me that you're black, I don't really think about it. Right?
No, you're right. I'm crazy.
And in fact, we went to dinner last night and
that
he
was
sat
wild.
At the Dolphin Bar and, we didn't sit at the bar though. Just want you to know that. He wanted to and I
communion,
said no.
Communion.
No, I'm just kidding. No, but.
I wanted to take communion.
But we were sitting... We're sitting in the vestibule waiting for our number to be spoken, but for our table to be ready. And Doc, they have there like an old-fashioned television set and also a barber chair. Mm-hmm. And he was sitting in the barber chair. And how many people?
Oh, Jesus. I'm going to say at least seven.
And I know I'd like to think most of them were
10,
kidding,
huh?
But they asked if they could get a haircut.
Right.
Or if the other way around.
Right.
And it was interesting because at that point in their mind, although I know people were just kidding and being friendly, but the barber chair defined you.
Right.
So really, we shouldn't let titles define us.
Right.
Because the glory is bigger than that. So in other words, we can't really get to know one another by our titles.
No.
But the glory will define us.
But you know, that's my whole story. That's why I'm Doc.
Yeah.
I know the ecclesiastical protocol.
Hallelujah.
I know the Kasak, the Shamir.
Oh, watch your language.
the Roche. I've had the 75-pound cross on. I've done the Episcopalian.
Hallelujah.
I done had the mitre on. I done did all that. I'm like, this ain't working for me. But now, the problem I had was several years ago, 2014, I joined this multi-level marketing group that didn't know me. In the religious world, you either called me Apostle Dr. Wright or Dr. Wright. That was it. And because of that, you never really got a chance to know me. Mm-hmm. You just knew the religion or the religiosity, if I would say it, of me. You never got to know me. So I'm dealing with these kids that are younger than my kids. Because some of you know my kids' age, so they're younger than my kids. I'm like, so how do I relate to them? Because I teach investment and leadership and all that good stuff. I need to find a way to relate to them. So they said, well, what is your name? Well, all I've known for 20-some years is Dr. Wright. That's my name. But you're 22 and you don't know anything about God. So from that point on, my name is Doc. So why they call you Doc? Well, I'm Doc. So what happened then was I'd go to these big meetings and I'd always get a group or crowd or corner. And I'm feeding. Well, how do you know so much about leadership? Well, this is what I really do. Well, you know, most preachers don't talk to us. Well, I'm going to talk to you because I need you. So relationship is Doc. In order for you to know the apostle all the signs and wonders, there has to be a relationship with God.
Yeah.
The problem we have from kingdom is, or people that say they're kingdom, they don't really want to establish relationship. They're still trying to build their own name. Mm-hmm. I don't have a name. It's kind of like you was talking about ethnicity, because we fail to realize this is just our covering.
Yeah, that's right.
God deals with the spirit of a man.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of like when I was 330 pounds, I said, I'm really not that big inside. You know, but if I fall down, I'm going to get back up. I just need you to understand. So, but we very seldom get a chance to know the real person.
Yeah, yeah.
Because we still have this religious facade. Yeah. Even in kingdom. So I have, my wife took me, she said, when you start telling people about your past, you have fun. What I do, because he brought me over.
Yeah, amen. Amen.
Trust. If I backslide, there's going to be an APBI. Mm, mm-hmm. They're going to say, excuse me, y'all, don't get offended. That Negro out, y'all.
Well, then could we say.
You can hide everything.
Can we say then, because a lot of people, though, they know somebody by title or by occupation. In fact, a lot of ministers, if they were to lose their churches, they cease to have an identity.
Yes, sir.
Because they don't know who they are, they know what they do.
Right.
Could we say that sometimes the church world got familiar with God's glory and what he does and not in knowing who he is?
See, that's what we're talking about today. Mm-hmm. But that's what we teach, though. Mm-hmm. Because the church don't really know who he is.
Yeah. Yeah. Because they've looked at what he can do.
And what he can do, and they looked at... Well, you know me, because I like to teach. So it's kind of like when I'm teaching Isaiah out of the Dead Sea Scrolls, to understand what King Jimmy wrote, it's two different facets. And so periodically the church has taught what King Jimmy wrote and not really researched to see what God desired.
Yeah, yeah.
So the church still has some inadequacies in their thought process. Mm-hmm. Because of what they've been taught, or like I started earlier, what grandma and them taught them. Mm-hmm. And so when they come to the comprehension, if you will, of the truth and who God really was, relatable, then some preachers, pastors, apostles, prophets, evangelists, teachers, ministers of the gospel, lay members in the church don't really know how to equate that. Mm-hmm. Because they still, I always say, stuck on stupid and leaning on dumb. They're still trying to prove themselves to be somebody.
Yeah.
That they already are.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's that reflect. I don't have to act and try to become something that I. So I've always taught this. The past 9 months, for real, I've gone into this. So I can't follow a lot of preachers on television anymore. Oh, I don't know how y'all do it. Yeah. Because they're not teaching precepts. They're teaching concepts.
Yeah, yeah.
The concept is, if I can touch the hem of his garment, I'll be healed. Well, the precept is, I'm the garment. Mm-hmm. So if I'm the garment, why do I need to touch?
I
am. You know, people say, well, where's the prayer oil? I need the prayer oil. Well, I'm sorry. If the Bible says the Holy Spirit represents all and the Holy Spirit is in me, well, then I'm oil.
Well, the glory.
I don't need to go buy no, what they call it, Evo. Which is that prayer oil? You got to get the right prayer oil. You can't just buy any kind of olive oil. It has to be.
Yeah. Well, really. I think what you're saying is that the glory, say what you were saying again. Say that again.
No, you didn't.
Yes, I did.
Oh, no. That was hot off the press. You got to record that. Who wrote it down? She got it.
Okay. There you go. Amen.
Now, wow. you can't get no
deep. She gets an
Come
A+.
On here, Reverend. That was deep. I couldn't even.
So talk a little more about that, because I think that's, we need to stay on that.
That's my message.
Oh, well.
No, it's good. No, but seriously, so most people would say, I like how she did the terminology of the tabernacle. So most people say, I'm just strange. So people get upset if they say, well, we need oil, or we need this, we need, I don't need to do anything that I am. And I think here's the problem with the church, because leaders want people to be up under them. No. I just want to be the root, baby. I just need to be the root that causes you to grow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Because I've always believed that every good teacher will teach themselves out of a position. I just need to be the root that caused you to grow. So, and all I need to do is just see little vines.
So this root, I think it's important that we understand that the root is where the glory proceeds from.
Right.
It doesn't proceed from a result.
Right.
In other words, glory will always proceed from the precept.
Right.
And whatever your precept is defines what you are glorifying.
So some people got some bad precepts.
Yeah.
Because they're still dealing with religion.
Mm-hmm.
And see, here's the funny thing. Jesus said, look, the greatest of you will be the least.
Mm-hmm.
But we still got people trying to be great.
Yeah.
You know, I tell Dr. Reed this all the time. I'm honored. I'm flipping flabbergasted that I'm sitting in this platform. I'm really, you know, I'm good. I'm a country boy. I'm a city boy. Went to private school. Got beat up every day. Moved down to the country. Became a migrant worker. Got beat up every day because I was too articulate. So now I'm just hood. Just trying to figure it out. So now I still got adversity because now I have the church world against me because I know who I am. And see, the church world gets upset once you understand, and pastors get upset, not just from a hierarchy role, but pastors get upset if you know who you are, because now you're causing them to have to teach better.
Mm-hmm.
And see, so what happens is if I'm a 12 and you become a 10 and I raise you to a 12, if I don't go to a 20, then you're going to leave.
Mm-hmm.
So there goes my Mercedes, there goes my Hummer, there goes my 5,000 square foot crib. Because you need to find somebody to feed you.
Mm-hmm.
To whereas if they understood who they were as the root, as the dust,
yeah,
as the precept, then they should stay lined up with,
yeah, yeah,
with the precept,
yeah,
so they can keep promoting and projecting you into your destiny.
Amen.
I have an issue with a church that has 5,000 members and nobody sits on the city council.
Yeah.
You know, I have an issue with that. I have an issue with a church that has 100 members and nobody has a business. I have an issue with that because you're not teaching kingdom, because kingdom tells me they have dominion to take over, to have control of.
Yeah.
I have to own something. And so I got people upset with me. They work for the government. They make $80,000 a year. I said, that's chicken change.
Yeah.
Well, we tithe. I know you do. You got to tithe. That's what God told you to do. That's, yeah, you know, that's just, that's between you and God. If you don't tithe, frankly, my dear, I don't give a darn because he's still going to bless.
Mm.
But what did he give you to be passionate about to establish your own?
Yeah.
Why haven't you started a business?
Amen.
Why haven't you bought some property?
Yeah.
Why haven't two or three of you got together and start flipping houses?
Yeah.
I see, I just took it to a whole nother level.
The thing is, I think we need to understand that when we speak of the glory of God like we're going to be doing today, we tend to think of it not any longer because we're the advanced group. But we have tended to think of that in a religious sense.
Right.
Like an emotional feeling or a burst of something and oh, he showed up. You know, he showed up before us. But when we talk about the glory, we have to also understand that it's going to be presenting the manifestation of dominion.
Right.
And so that means that we can't expect to depend on the world's systems to take dominion and territory that God said we're supposed to possess for him.
Yeah, they can't.
Because the glory, now I want you to get this, the glory will actually reveal innovative ideas of how you can get what you need for him and his kingdom without sorrow. But these are some of the dimensions we have not really investigated with the glory because we thought, well, we want to ask God's glory to help us in the world system.
Right. Instead of making our own system.
Yeah. Instead of recognizing we're supposed to present a whole new economy.
Mother was sharing that with us last night when she talked about having a kingdom council, if you will.
Yeah.
To instead of going to the government when we have personal issues, mm-hmm, we go to the council.
Do you want to share just a minute about
when
that?
When we have personal issues.
Wait, about that, what you said last night.
Huh? Yeah, I'm going to sit down.
He's
Isn't this
down.
Wonderful? You know, the hierarchy isn't God. We're all one in Jesus. We have different functions, but the hierarchy is wrong. It's like I'm up here and you're down here. No, none of us are like that way in the kingdom. But what I was talking about was that, you know, how God has told us in his word not to go to the courts of the heathen, right? To try to solve our problems. That's why we shouldn't sue anybody, because then it's a bigger mess. And, there's times that you have to, I understand. You don't have anything else, right? And it's things that are unfair and unjust. And unfortunately, we don't have such a just system anymore. Justice is like a blurry word anymore. But the kingdom has justice for everyone.
Yeah.
And we're truly free. If we don't think in a religious way, you know, I'm up here and you're down here, or I'm down here and they're up there, right? If we just get that out of our mentality, because God made us one, why should we mess that up,
yeah,
right? But we need a council, at least in our local embassy. Mm-hmm. What is an embassy? We're here to represent another kingdom,
yeah,
another country, right? And we do it with diplomacy,
yeah. Amen.
Not with force.
Yeah.
And we know we have dominion, but we're humble. Mm-hmm. We don't go and just take over and everybody knows we're taking over because we're Christians.
Yeah.
No, that word shouldn't even get out there, to be honest with you. We should be strategic about what we do in the embassy.
Yeah.
One of my pet peeves is that we put all our culture and all our stuff on the internet. Yes. People don't want to know that.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, it works against us, not in our favor. But we should be strategic. We should have strategic meetings as an embassy. Mm-hmm. Because we are going to decide what the world is going to do.
Yes.
Not the world telling us what they're going to do.
Yeah.
And so the more that we have that mind of Christ in us, the more we're going to be thinking that way. So the council that we need to have righteous people, and not in the sense of religious, because we hear that word so much. We're righteous. We're going to take over. We, you know, this earth is ours. Yes, it is. It's God's. But we can possess it.
Yeah.
Amen. All of it.
Amen.
Yes. God sent us to do that,
yes,
to possess, to change. But we have to do it one by one, and we have to do it in the love of the Lord. We have to love people to them to come to the kingdom as little children.
Yeah.
How do we love little children? We just accept them. We just tell them to come in.
Amen.
And they do. And it's that simple. Yes, it's that simple. But in the matters of the embassy, in the matters of the church, we need to have a council that has judges. Now, just because the word judge has been so misused, we do judge every day. I judge how I'm going to dress myself. I judge myself. I manage myself. So we're constantly making decisions and making judgments.
Well, we're talking government. That's what
we're
you're talking
government.
About.
Exactly. We need to get used to this.
Mm-hmm.
And so have a council that at least in the local church, or we can start it in local church, that we make decisions. How many people leave churches? They are mad. They misbehaved. They did something that wasn't proper. And what do? They leave the church because they didn't like that they've been corrected.
Right.
Or they don't want to be corrected. And because of this democracy that we live in, I'm not saying democracy is wrong, hear me, for a country, for a nation, but God is not democratic. God's not taking a vote.
That's right.
He already said what he's going to say, and we need to follow his...
Amen.
Instruction. What is his instruction? It's his laws.
Amen.
And the laws make sense.
Amen.
Because that's what David said. The law of the Lord is perfect.
Yes, amen.
Why? Not because we are going to be judged in... Jesus already defeated the punishment of the law. So we don't have to even think about that anymore.
Amen.
Get it
amen.
Out of your head. The law of the Lord, the instruction of the Lord, is what we judge every day.
Amen.
And so if there's people in trouble that need guidance, then, it's good to have a council of righteous people, I'm thinking,
yeah,
that can, there's disputes. Sometimes, she took that was mine. Nobody knows, but it was mine, and she took it. So, therefore, we have having a loving council,
mm-hmm,
that is truly non-selfish, that is not out to say we rule here and we're the hierarchy of God. No, we're not. We're all one, but we do help one another.
I like the word that you say. You use the word organic.
Organic. Something organic that happens because it's God and because nobody wants to be above anybody else. As a matter of fact, the reason why he said the greatest is the littlest.
Yeah.
And the littlest becomes the greatest is because if without humbleness and without thinking, don't think of yourself. Think of the people that we're serving.
Yes,
and in whatever position God have us to, to serve, to be available for
amen.
That position.
Amen. So give us some wind-up thoughts, and I'm going to have our MCs are here, and I'm going to ask them to lead us in a worship song as we get prepared for what I'm going to share in our first, our second, or whatever the session is. I don't know. But give us a wind-up thought to kind of get us motivated and ready for what we got.
Can I?
Sure.
I hear James Brown hollering, please,
please.
I'm sorry, praise the Lord.
So I feel good.
Look out now.
Sorry.
So here's something I did at our church several months ago. We still got to get it all together. Several years ago, I had an investment corporation in the body with the purpose of investing in the market. Now, if anybody knows me, I know the market. I just talk trash, but I know the market. And so we started it. Some people dropped out, and I let it go dormant. I'm still in the market. I'm in the market constantly, but I let it go dormant. And one of the members, so I have a book club. So I will no longer position anybody in the ministry unless they're in my book club. Because you have to know what I know. You have to know how I flow. I don't have time to teach you. Readers are leaders, and most people in the church don't read. And therefore, not only can you not lead, you're not even doing anything for your family. I'm not going to get big on education. You know, I've always been a reader. This is what kept me the way I was back in the day. Anyway, so one of the members chimed up in the middle of the book club, why don't we start an investment company? And so I bashed it off. I said, so why would you want to start an investment company? She said, well, Dad, you had an investment company in the church before. I said, yes, and everybody calls us Mom and Dad, so it's nothing. But for me, that's special because that means now I got to make sure I take care of you. So I said, well, but you have to understand that means there's something that you have to do monthly as far as putting money together in a fund to put into the market. And here's why I'm saying this. So we went January, we decided to do another one. They're waiting on me. I already have the IN number. I already have the company. I just got to open a bank account. And here's why I say this. So I'm going to point some people out. It's not prophetic. I'm just pointing you out. Like, for some reason, I like them three over there. Don't know why. I don't know them. I think I saw them before. Maybe I'm young. I don't know. Huh? So you figure you take them three right there. That's three. And these four back here. You could take three or four, that's seven. I just thought about that. So those seven, which means something's completed, those seven can come together and put up $80 a month apiece in a fund. They can take that fund and then buy stocks that's going to pay them a dividend. They can do that for a year, reinvest the stocks, and then they can go out and together as a corporation establish credit to go buy property. So once you buy the property, you have seven people that have a corporation that is equally divided, and you start buying property. Your house is not an asset. Your house is a liability. So my duty is to learn how to rent out my house so I can make income off of my house. Because other than that, trust me, I've had my house for 20-some years, and now this rehab is like a new crib. So I have to figure out some stuff. So wouldn't it be amazing? I don't know anything about Port St. Lucie. But wouldn't it be amazing if you got to a place to where as you say, okay, I heard Doc, it is March, let's get together, let's get a name, boom, we're gonna do this. We start making our first investment in May, and we do this until May of 2023. Mm-hmm. We see how much we have, and now we go talk to a real estate agent to look for some property that we can rehab. Because we have construction people in the church. So now we just gave them a business. They have employment because we're going to pay them market. I don't do this brother stuff. We're going to pay them the market to rehab the house that we're getting ready to flip. Now, why do we do this? Because now we're building kingdom. Because what happens now is, as a corporation, we have a 20% tithe to give to the church.
Yeah.
While we're making 80% income. And because we set up a trust fund, we now have an inheritance for our children and our children's children and our children's children's children, because that's what he told us to do.
Now what we just heard was the council. And are you ready for this? What we just heard was actually the glory of the Lord.
Yeah.
Because we haven't known we could make the glory of the Lord practical application. We thought it just came and went.
Right.
But he said, I'm not with visitation anymore. I have habitation. So now with what he shared, how many of you know that was valuable information right there? But it was more than information. It's spiritual inspiration that will bring transformation if we act upon what we're going to hear today. Amen. So let's stand together. Thank you, Doc.
Oh, my pleasure. Thank you.
Amen. We'll hear more from Doc in just a little bit. Come on, everybody stand. And we have our MCs here, and we're going to adjust things just a little bit in the schedule. Would you lead us in worship, greet us, and then, what are you doing? Oh, okay. And then I'm going to come on.
Absolutely. So, good morning, everybody. I'm Courtney Kendall. I am their daughter in love, and it is such a privilege and honor. This is my husband and their middle son, Jay Kendall. I might call him Jonathan through the day, so it's habit. So if you hear that, I mean him. So we are so sorry that we are late. I think that when the enemy knows that we're going to come and be filled up so abundantly through the day, he likes to mess with us. So as I was passing everyone in the no passing lane of Indian River Drive, I said, not today, Satan. So here we are. Go ahead, say a little
something. Welcome. Yeah, so we're so happy to be here. She's definitely a better speaker than I am. But we're just so happy to see everybody here. This is a CATS meeting, and this is so, can we give her a round of applause for a CATS meeting? We also want to pray for Chris, Pastor Chris Turney, as we know that he's not feeling too well. It's best, though, you know, wisdom is to just, you know what, man, I just need to kick back and I just need to be careful. He's always so busy. He's on the road. So can we give a hand for him as well? So we're a little out of order because of what was happening this morning. But we actually there's not really a reason why we're late. But we actually have something special. But before we do that, we were going to talk about innovating on how we, as a younger generation, but now we think we're the younger generation, but there's actually a younger one below us.
Yes, there is.
Yeah, if you want to sit down, you guys can. I just like when you're standing for me. That's fine. Would you stand back? I'm just kidding. That's what we do in kids' church, and the kids always, you know, they get so upset. but innovating, something that came into my mind, and I'll let her speak on what she wanted to say, was our generation, for sure, learning to grow. So really, I mean, it seems pretty simple what we're saying, but actually what it is that the generations, our generation, who we are, need to adapt and understand that we need to learn, which means be humble, to grow. The only way we can grow is, and I'm going to be honest with you, those of you who are around of our age set or whatever, this generation, but we tend to think that we know what we're doing, especially because of the information highway. We think that we even know more than our elders. That can come across that way, because once I see my dad fiddle with his phone saying, how do I do this? It doesn't mean that I see him as weak. But at the same time, let me fix it. There's a lot of things that, you know, a younger generation can fix, but that doesn't mean that we have the knowledge to push forward and grow. So, and I do that a lot, and that's okay. If anybody needs help with their iPhone, I got you. But the thing is to grow, meaning that we need to seek the leadership that is our elders. We need to seek those who have been down a path who can say, listen, here's what to expect. But there's also people who, and I know because we've asked like some of the elders, hey, can you, and they're like, oh, well, you wouldn't get it. This is why we need to work as a team to grow who we are. And it takes a both of learning on both. I mean, I'm just saying for me and for anybody else, if I want to be mentored or if I want to, that there takes a both set of learning. And I do have some younger guys that I mentor now that are much younger than me. But you know, I'm starting to say to them, I was like, hey, you know, I don't ever want to push you into doing something you don't want to do. Is there anything that I can help learn from you that you can help learn from me? And I believe that that's really something that's missing. And a lot of people, especially, you know, I know ministers, it's hard because we tend to, you know, even if you're not a minister, you're just a minister of the word, but you hold on to something so much because it's your legacy. And you're like, do I give it up? But it's really not just about that. It's just about learning and growing together. And this is what the generation is doing. You know, like our daughter, Lucy, she's 10 and she's smarter than both of us combined. So, and Mrs. Know-It-All. But it's so important because we just see sometimes kids as just kids. But then she'll say something that's just like, wow, it's out of this world. But learning to grow, it's even with that generation saying, like, what can we do to help better you? Because when we do that, we actually better ourselves. And that's something through, you know, what God's really been inspiring on my heart for that. And I think it's so great because it's not about a power trip or a power authority. It's that we've already have that authority, but then what do we do with that? And that authority is actually submitting and learning to those around us. So that's something that came upon my heart to learn to grow. And it seems like just a short sentence, but isn't it so hard to do sometimes? Especially when you think you know what's right for somebody to do. Those of you who have kids, and maybe they're doing something you don't agree with, how do you love them? Or maybe they're doing everything that you agree with, but you still butt heads. And how do you do that? There's so much to that. But again, and what we do is to love and to learn that we're still learning. You know, as much, my dad will tell me, he's like, I'm still learning what I'm doing. And that's awesome because it makes me feel like, wow, can I learn with you, you know? So learn to grow. That's something that came upon my heart with that. And do you have any couple words on that?
Yeah, so basically the one thing when we were praying about it and preparing for this seminar, which is so near and dear to our heart because we're in full-time ministry ourselves, and it's draining, and we give a lot, and it's so nice to be here with like-minded people where we can be built up and filled to go back out and minister to other people, because that's what we're called to do, love God, love others. So something that came upon our heart was honoring our elders, and that's what we'd like to do today by honoring our mom and dad. So I'm a pastor's kid too. I grew up in a Southern Baptist church. Lord help me. And so I was on the platform on a stool when I was 3 years old singing and leading worship. So it just manifested its way through then. But then life led me down a very rocky road, and I followed the ways of the world. And God has totally redeemed my life. And brought me this family that I never thought I could have or fit in with or be worthy of. And I remember our second date. It was we had gone on our first date on a Thursday. He invited me to the CATS conference in 2019. We were at the old KRM facility, and it was our first weekend that we had a date, and we had the conference, and it was the first time I heard him lead worship. And there's these beautiful pictures of everybody worshiping and being with my parents, who I was ashamed of where I had come from. I was ashamed. I wear these tattoos like scars of the past. You know, so here I am walking in with my crazy hair and my tattoos and my, you know, going, hey, well, I'm not that bad, I swear, you know. But the cool thing was they loved me exactly who I was. They never judged me. I had a child. I had a pass-failed marriage. I had all of these things. But when I walked in, I was their daughter. And that's the way that Christ loves. And the way that Christ loves is the way they've loved me and my daughter Lucy and Jonathan. And Jay has a brother and a sister, an older and a younger. So they have just loved us and honored us when we didn't deserve it at all, when we let them down, when we disappointed them. And they have honored us, and we would like to take this opportunity to honor them.
I just realized I probably look like my dad, my hands in my pockets while my...
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. It's okay. It's admiration. But I don't know if anybody knows, but their 50th anniversary is coming up. Now, that is in June, correct? Just want to make sure because she had to remind me. So, but we wanted to, because we wanted to make something special. Now, we know June is a little bit of way, but we wanted to do something special for your 15th anniversary here. So, before we do, some people want to say hello.
Hello, Liz and Papa Rick. I hope you have a really good conference. I wish you luck. Thank you for everything you've done for the family and accepting us into your family. I can tell my mom loves Jay very much. And thank you for all that you've done for us. You've invited us to play games. You made us tacos. You've just made our life very fun. And thank you for that. I wish you luck.
Hi, me, Mom, Papa.
Hi.
We're being a little silly right now in the car, but we are at a gas station. We are parked, don't worry. We just came back from a special place that I took the kids for the end of spring break. But we heard about this opportunity to tell you about how super special and loved you are by us. So we didn't want to miss it, so we are recording this in the car. But we just wanted to tell you that we are so thankful for you, like in too many ways that I can't even begin to express to you. We are just like, I don't know how we were so blessed or why God chose us to be your daughter and your grandchildren, but we are just always so influenced in the best way by your relationship that you have together with each other, and your marriage is just such a testament. Just it's just awesome to have you guys to look up to, and we're so thankful for you. So we just wanted to tell you a couple of the ways that you're super special to us and why we love you. And Richard, do you want to go first?
Yeah, sure. Well, I love you guys because you do a lot of stuff for us, and they're just really nice, and you always like help me whenever I'm just like having trouble with something.
Yeah, and how about you, Noah?
Because you guys always take care of us, like Mima in the morning. If we don't have breakfast, she'll take us somewhere to eat. She always provides stuff for us to help us in any way. And Papa is just the best, like, in every way. And we love you guys a lot because you take care of us.
Yeah. How about you, Georgie?
You guys are the best.
What else?
Nothing.
Georgie's a little shy.
No.
How about you, Elle?
Because you guys always, whenever I do anything good, you guys are always so proud of me, and you guys always, like, support me in anything I do.
Yep. You guys are the absolute best. We could not even, like I said, we're just blessed, and we feel so thankful to have you, and we're constantly thankful for that. We just may not always show it because we're so busy, but... Thanks, Mom and Dad. Thanks for everything that you do for my children and for me, and for being just, in my opinion, the greatest people alive. I may be a little biased, but I think that a lot of people would agree with me that you guys are some of the best human beings you can come across, and we're just so appreciative that God put you not only in our lives, but as such an important role in our lives. So we love you. You are so special to us. And happy anniversary soon. And we'll see you soon. Bye.
It's your firstborn son. Hey, Mom and Dad. It's your son and another son, the one up in the sky. Two important parts of your life that bring life and cause growth and what else? Shine brightly, what else? No, but really, I love you guys. I wanted to say congratulations on your 50th wedding anniversary. Guys, there was a time when I wasn't sure you were gonna make it, and now I feel like I'm a part of this beautiful love story about restoration and about saying you're sorry and about listening and admitting when you're wrong, which is huge. Not a lot of parents do that for their kids in the way that you guys did it, so thank you. And thank you for always checking in with me, Jay, and Victoria over the years to make sure we're okay and encouraging us to be ourselves as crazy as we get sometimes. I love you and I wish you the happiest anniversary, and I'm sorry I can't be there. Love you guys. Bye.
It's all right. You can cry. We have the original videos. They're not cut off. It's just the way that it was edited, but we have those for you. But we also have a gift for you. So if we can have my mom and dad come up.
Sorry, if somebody could bring us up two chairs, we'd like to put two chairs right up here in front of the podium. You guys can have a seat and we'll give you your gift. And then what we would like to do is sing a blessing over our parents. And what we're going to invite you to do is if everybody could come up and lay hands on mom and dad, and we're going to pray over them and pray over their lives and their future and their legacy and everything they've done for us. So come on up. Lay your hands on them, and we're going to sing a blessing over them.
The Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. Lord, turn his face towards you and give you peace.
Amen.
We sing,
children. May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and
your children and your children
and their children.
May his favor be upon you and a thousand generations, and your family and your children and their children. and the children. May his favor be upon you and the thousand generations and your family and your children and the children and the children in the morning, in the evening, and you're coming, and you're going, and you're weeping, and rejoicing. He is for you. 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 Let's sing again. He is for you. 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 He is for you.
He is for
you. Amen.
He is for you.
Amen. 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 Sing again.
Lift up a shout of praise, everybody. Amen.
All right, you guys can make your way back to your seats. Get comfy. Thank you for praying over them. That means so much. Daddy, would you like to speak or you want to do a break? Okay, so Dad's going to go ahead and speak.
Did they open their gift?
Not yet, but they can open.
Okay, whatever you guys like to open that. Isn't that awesome? We that's an exchanging of, that's an exchanging of power and authority. That's because we care. It's so great to see, that 50th anniversary, which is really great. I know some of you in here maybe have more. But you know what's so great is that in love and integrity, there is growth. But again, in learning, because none of us know it all, so except for him. But just kidding. But that's what it's all about, and we hope you guys feel. I know you got to go on with everything. We're so sorry. We wanted to make sure that happened. So, but we want to invite my father, Dr. Rick Kendall, back up.
Wow, I had no idea. I had no idea. I just had no idea. Wow. Thank you. Thank you for, gosh. I had no idea. I honestly had no idea. I didn't. We don't know how to handle that kind of thing. I just, honestly, we just don't know how to use words, but especially when your own kids.
I know, babe. The kids that we made, we didn't make them. God did.
It was shake and bake. We helped.
Oh. We didn't expect any one of them. They were all surprises. They were blessings. But your children, what does the Bible says? That they will rise up and bless you. And your children will bless you too. And there's nothing more. Thank you so much. I think I had like five of these. We weren't expecting that. It's not about us. But it's about us. It's about us. But I just remember that when you were talking about us being, I mean, being Mexican and being American and how we blended that. We didn't think about those things. I mean, it's just God, you know, and that's how organic we should be. Yeah. Nothing is made up in the kingdom, only what God created. And, you know, I'm your wife, not because you were a pastor. You know, that's why sometimes I resent the fact that we're called pastor's wives. Because I'm not a pastor's wife. I'm his wife. What if he was a janitor? I mean, and you were a janitor and at college. You clean toilets there and stuff. You do get paid. So, yeah. What if... But it's organic. But yeah, but what if you know, it's not. It's your identity is what matters in God, because then you're not. You know, you're not somebody's wife. You're not somebody's. You know, whatever your husband does, that's what you are. And it's okay. I'm not ashamed to be called a janitor's wife. You know. Because the identity in Christ is what really matters. And this is what I pray that we can instill in our children. Because your children is line on the fence number one, right? They're going to go into the world to be able to make a change. So what we want to do is instill in them, know that they can do everything and whatever. Which we did that. And we always, you know, believe in what they were already formed and created to do. We just encourage them. But it's more about their identity in Christ, in the kingdom. If you know who you are, nobody can stop you to do what God has called you to do. And that's basically what we taught them. But to see it in action, you know, we're talking about the seed and the dust in the seed. Oh my goodness, that's such a great revelation. And you know, I wanted to say I appreciate, I don't know how to thank everybody for putting this together, and Pastor Jill and Apostle, and doing, letting us be here to do this. But, you know, because I know what it is to set up chairs. I know what it is for 50 years to be doing these things and start over and do it again and do all that. I know what it is, and I know how much sacrifice it goes into it, believe me. But it's just how organic it happens. Instead of making it happen. So when we got married, we had to work on our relationship because we didn't have the identity of Christ. We had the identities that we had. And for a long time, I was a pastor's wife and I felt like trapped, but I trapped myself. You understand? So we need to manage ourselves and to realize that the identity will only come when you claim it, when you go get it. Don't let anybody call you anything that you're not. As a matter of fact, you can't stand against it. You can stand up and say, you don't have to fight. You can just stand and say, no, I'm not that. You're calling me? I'm not that. I know I'm not that. And we have to reassure ourselves and stand against what the enemy says we are. You know, and like how things are right now, that's happening a lot. But I'm not going to let that happen because I am going to assure myself of God's identity in me. And that's what I believe that we have instilled in our kids. And we are so honored that you did that. Had no idea. I'm a little mad, but not really. It's like, you didn't know, we didn't know. But that's okay. We all need humbleness, yeah, right? But thank you so much for doing that, guys. And God bless you. We believe in you.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you, baby. Amen. Amen. Wow. Doc, are you praying for me?
Yes, sir.
I'm just so full of emotion. I just can't even express. So we forge on. Is it okay if we forge on? And it's great to have Pastor back here. Stand and just say hi to everybody. In fact, come on up here. Come up here. This is this guy has transitioned his church from where, you know, it was more of a, you can explain it, but you've come into the kingdom. Come on, somebody.
Say hallelujah. Praise the Lord. I can feel that. I can see the presence of God. I don't only feel it, but I can see it because it is visible. The presence is in this room. And if you are here, you can see it. And those who are listening online, you can see the presence. It is being manifested. Glory to God. I am blessed to be in the house of the Lord. Praise God. We are rejoiced to be here. I will not miss this. The last cult meeting I went to was, I think, 2018 in Boynton Beach. Every year I forgot about it, so I didn't request it early enough. This year, to my wonderful wife, March 19, we can't miss it. I was introduced to the kingdom message by Dr. Rick Kendall at Evangelical Bible College and Seminary, and it has transformed my life. And like everybody was saying, it revealed to me who I was, my true identity in Christ. Before I introduce my wife, there is something I learned in high school and in college, but when I understood the kingdom message, I realized that it was all wrong. You know, Maslow said the priority in life or the hierarchy of need, where we need water, we need food, we need a house, a shelter, and we need to really be happy in general. But then Jesus said, no, don't worry about water. Don't worry about food. Don't worry about what you're going to wear. But seek first the kingdom and the righteousness of God. And everything else will be added unto us. So we used to run after everything else but the kingdom. Then we had nothing. But now we move toward the kingdom and everything else is just following us. So we give God the glory. My name is Pastor Vinay Sherstein. I am the pastor of Victory in the Darkness Church in Lake Worth. We are happy to be here. We've been in this ministry for over 3 years. It wasn't an easy call. When God called me, I really didn't want to be a pastor. I wanted to be an evangelist. I love going around preaching and say, this is it. Nothing to worry about. But God says no. And he has proven to be right, just like every other time. So I give him the glory. And one of the things he did before I get into ministry was blessing me with a wonderful wife. And I definitely wouldn't be able to do it without her. But God knew that, so he made sure I had her before we started ministry. It is, we thank God, we have a fast and growing ministry. Our service are in Creole and English. And Dr. Weekender, we had the privilege of having him pouring into our ministry one day, because that's what he does. He pour whatever God bless him with, he just pour it on other people. And that's why today we can be here with the kingdom message. And I love the kingdom message because it is the message. And I've listened to a lot of the preachers, so I'm excited to be here. I can't wait to see what God is going to do in this place. I've already been transformed by the beautiful work of the family. Praise God. I appreciate it. It's wonderful because they more than deserve it. They have invested on other people, so it was nice to just get a little bit in return. Pastors, we do talk a lot, but I don't want to keep going.
Hello, everybody. I won't say much. It's very nice to be here, and I feel like the Holy Spirit. While we were praying, I feel like it's just like home, you know, my church, you know. So it's just like I feel like filled with the Spirit. So just stay connected with one love, because God, it's love. Amen. It's very nice, and I really enjoy it to be here. So, love you all, guys.
We love you guys.
Amen. Thank you so much. Wow, we saw what God has done in 3 years down there with their church. And it's amazing. The place was full of people hungry for the kingdom. Amen. Amen. You know, right now, I think if I see him back here, is Jeremiah in the room? Jeremiah? Now, you might think he's one of the Luden cough drop guys, but I want you to come up. He's a great man of God and a powerful pastor down in Lake Worth. Let's give a hand to Jeremiah, who's going to tell us a little bit about the school and whatever you got on your heart.
God is good. Amen? Amen. Am I the only one that felt like when you two were up here earlier, they were reading your mail? Yeah, yeah, right? Just things that are on your heart, but things you need to hear. Yeah. Amen. Thank you for being obedient and saying it, even if some things we didn't want to hear. Yeah. All right. But God is amazing. Amen. So he already introduced myself. I'm Dr. Jeremiah Ramberg. I'm one of the professors at Evangelical Bible College and Seminary. And I just want to say again, welcome to everybody that's here today. And if you are a member of our Bible college, if you are a student, make sure you see me today and sign up so you get credit today for that. I know it's always dangerous to hand someone a microphone, but I do have something on my heart. Whew. One of my favorite stories in the Bible is in Mark chapter 2, and it's when the four men brought the man who was paralyzed to see Jesus. And I love it because it starts out and says Jesus was in the house, you know? And everybody was there, and it says in the word that it was so much that they were pressed. They were out the door. They were in the windows. And this was a word that was spoken to me when I was young, and it always resurfaces. Amen. Don't you love how there's nothing like the word of God. Amen. Because you can read a scripture verse on a Monday morning and it can mean something to you, but then read it again on Tuesday morning. It can mean something completely different. Same verse, but speak to you in a different way. It's a story that resurfaces in my life so many different times as I grow older and of course grew in my relationship with God. But it was taught to me to think about those four men. Never gives their name. But it talks about the four men that were carrying the one who was sick of the palsy, the one that couldn't carry himself. And they brought him. And when they got to the house, they didn't look and say, hey, we're sorry, buddy. We did our best. We're good friends, but we can't get in to see this man that we've heard so much about, that the noise was going around of what this man can do. We can't get you inside. We're sorry. And that would be such an amazing worldly excuse. It makes sense. Are they good friends? Yes, they're carrying their brother around. Did they try? Yes, they tried. And if they got there and didn't press on, it would be acceptable in worldly terms. Well, you did your best. You tried. Thanks for being a good friend. But no, they carried him up to the roof. However people want to interpret the scripture, whether there was a door there, whether it was, you know, whether they, it says in the word of God, they broke it open. So whatever it was, they didn't stop. And I just picture Jesus standing there and stuff falling down. And I imagine our Lord was still continuing with what he had to say because he knew exactly what was going to happen. And the reason why I'm sharing all that this morning is because that's what I feel things like this are. I thank God for you. I thank God for what you mean to me. I thank God for what you mean to my pastor and what you've done for him. And my pastor, David Donnelly, is my mentor. So I will always love you for what you've spoken to his life. Amen. But it's made me start to think of who I surround myself with. Because if you remember, those four men laid, they lowered that man down at Jesus' feet. And you remember what Jesus said next? He told the man that his sins are forgiven. He told the man that he was going to be healed. But he looked up and it said, it's because of the faith of your friends. It's because of their determination. That brother in the bed never said a word. He never asked for it. He was healed because of the faith of his friends. And I started looking at who do I surround myself with? Who's going to carry me? I'm not a small fella. Who's going to carry me up? It might take more than just four friends. But it really started to have me, you know, reevaluate who I am surrounding myself with. And when you start surrounding yourself with people who are kingdom-minded, they're going to carry you to that roof. And you're going to start looking, because then you start thinking not only of who you surround yourself with, but what kind of friend am I? am I going to do whatever I can to make sure that someone gets to the feet of our Savior? So I just want to encourage you, don't let this be the last conference you attend. Don't let it be the last seminar you attend. Come and be fed as much as these, let me tell you, these are praying men. These are praying women. These are people that put a lot of time into studying, and we need to open up our ears and our hearts and our minds and be ready to receive what God has for us today. Amen? Amen. God bless. Thank you.
Wow. What an emotional morning. I mean, it's the Holy Ghost. Amen? We do what He wants. I want to just share with you just in this session, and then we may, it might be lunchtime, so we'll have Doc in the afternoon. Then I want to share in the afternoon a very brief personal word to you to kind of not commission you, because that may not be my place in your life, but to share with you a commission. Amen? A challenge, because this, again, as we said, this is not just about you being an audience, which obviously you have not been today, but it's about being participants. Can I tell you, not to stir up hype or anything, but the reality of it is, it's the best truly is yet to come. Amen. And you're the best that's coming. Yeah. Amen. So it's vital. Everybody say vital. Yeah. It's vital that you get your instructions, not from a man, but from the Lord. And that you hear what He's saying right now, because many of you, I can't say all of you, I don't know that. Many of you, all of you are going into a new level. But many of you are not going to recognize that level. And you're going to have to say, I'm going anyway. And it's going to cause you to have to leave some stuff behind. Amen. And that's not going to be easy. Believe me, as people who have had to shift a lot, we're still on the journey with you. Amen? We're still shifting. But I want you to understand what I'm sharing with you in this session, what Doc will share, and then with me a personal word, and then we're going to have a round table that's not going to be on Facebook. But this whole thing is about you and what God has purposed you to do in this hour. So how many of you can receive what we're about to say in that light? So I want to talk to you about our theme, and it's a G2 seminar. It's a G2 seminar, or glory to glory. Glory, if you're keeping notes, glory always excels itself. Always. God's never going to go back to things the way they were done. He's advancing. He's already there, but we're advancing with Him. So I want you to, as our brother, our Jeffrey in the back and Lady Jill are going to help us to proceed. I've tried to do some slides so you can get some notes, because this is rather extensive. I'm going to skip through, I don't know what that is. That's good. Oh, this is dedicated to Dr. Miles Monroe's legacy. Oh, there we go. Okay, so the next slide, please. Next slide. I'm not going to talk about all that. Okay, how many of you have heard of the G8 conference? I think it ended in 2014. These guys, I guess, couldn't get along. And so they still meet, but in other, I guess Russia at some point was asked to leave the G8. Then it became the G20, and I'm not sure what it is right now, but they're still trying to get together. And they're leaders from countries gathering in unity, or so-called unity, to address global issues. Much of the world counts on these guys. Much of the world is in turmoil because their trust was misplaced. And they don't feel like they have leaders in the world. So globalization, everybody say globalization, is defined as the process by which businesses or other organizations develop international influence or start operating on an international scale. It's interdependence of nations around the globe fostered through free trade. Now, I know that was a mouthful, but basically, you could say it this way. Globalization is not kingdom. Globalization, the problem with it is operated by corrupted systems. So not all unity is good. Not all unity is good when it's tied to corrupted systems or religion. Religion, if you've noticed, has actually gone along with much of what the world is trying to accomplish. They've even showed up to try to be supportive of certain political parties. And I don't know, Republican or Democrat is not the issue. It's not right or left, it's right or wrong. Amen? So Romans chapter 1, verses 21 and 22, it says concerning this that we're faced with today, because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God. Neither were they what? Thankful, but became vain in their imaginations. Imaginations comes from the word images. They became vain in their imaginations, and their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. So, religious subcultures want the glory of the past to substantiate where they're going in their future. Let me say this. This isn't on a slide, but it's the Holy Ghost. World cultures are always cultivated from the past. Kingdom culture is cultivated from a prophetic future. It is literally what God has already called done, but hasn't manifested yet. So God's idea of history is a mystery. A mystery didn't just happen when it unfolded. It's just when you got in on it. So the kingdom that is already complete hasn't manifested yet because you're the one presenting it to the world. So I don't love you or hate you based on the cultures of the past, because I'm a kingdom citizen. And as a kingdom citizen, I love you based on what you haven't even become yet that God already says you are. That was good. I enjoyed that. Religious subcultures want to glory in the past where they've been comfortable in their misery. Did you know you can get comfortable in your misery? And by the way, you throw all those pity parties and nobody comes? You put on Facebook how bad it is? Oh, did I say that out loud? They want to stay where they've been in tradition. Religion is unessential, but God's kingdom glory renovates the world. But we've played with the glory. We've just kind of visited the glory. We're kind of afraid of the glory where religion is concerned. But when you come into the kingdom, you become governed by the glory. Oh, come on, somebody. So I want to set up this foundation so that we can see where we're going. 2 Corinthians. Now, this is kind of extensive reading, as you can see up there. So maybe you can bring it up on your Bibles or your phones, you know. But 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 7 through 18, it speaks of Moses. And it says, if the ministration of death, written, engraven in stones, was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his what? Countenance. Say countenance. Which glory was to be done away. What did I say? 2 Corinthians 3:7? I was just testing to see if you were. So, hey, it's not my fault. I'm still full from what just happened here. I'm doing my best to get in, but I've got something to say from the Lord. Amen. So let me read it again. If the ministration of death, written and engraven in stones, was glorious, so that the children of Israel could not steadfastly behold the face of Moses for the glory of his countenance, which glory, look at this, which glory was to be done away. See, we've just tried to hold on to some glory that's not relevant anymore. How shall not the ministration of the Spirit be rather glorious? For if the ministration of condemnation be glory, much more doth the ministration of righteousness exceed in glory. For even that which was made glorious had no glory in this respect. By reason of the glory that what? Excels. Now I know why you weren't saying anything to me. For if that which is done away was glorious, much more that that remains is glorious. Seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech, and not as Moses, who put a veil over his face, that the children of Israel could not steadfastly look to the end of that which is what? Abolished. Much of what's being called religion today has actually been abolished. I didn't abolish it. You didn't abolish it. God abolished it because it was preventing us from seeing the greater glory. Some people want to move into the greater glory and carry some of the old with them. And it's not going to change the world. And that's what we're about today. So it says in verse 12, seeing then that we have such hope, we use great plainness of speech. And then it goes on to say, as I read that already, verse 14, their minds were blinded, for until this day remains the same veil untaken away in the reading of the Old Testament, which veil is done away in Christ. But even unto this day, when Moses is read, the veil, you know, they said this several times, didn't they? The veil is upon their heart. Nevertheless, when it shall turn to the Lord, the veil shall be taken away. Can I tell you what we're about to see? I'm speaking prophetically. Is another part of the veil being lifted. God already lifted it. But some of us take our time getting there. But there's some things you got to let go of. There's things I thought was a major part of my ministry that God said, I don't need that anymore. In fact, I never did. And I thought it was a major part of who I am because of what I did. But God says, I'm not in what you did. I'm in who I am. Church tradition, everybody say church tradition, has put a veil preventing God's glory from being revealed. Oh, come on, somebody. They've accepted visitation instead of habitation. Oh, Lord, come down. God says, I already did. Keeping us from seeing God is rising up. We use traditional language. And I said some of this at the conference the other day, but God said, say it here too. We've used traditional language like, let's go reap a harvest of souls. Hallelujah. And if you were to ask some ministers, what do you mean by that? They'd say, let's go get them. Let's bring them into church. And let's reap that harvest. But what does that mean? It means go get them. bring them in, fill the seats. And that's where we were. And we misunderstood harvest because a veil was there called religion that said going and reaping a harvest of souls is getting them into the church and filling the seats. Write this down. They treated seed time as though it were harvest time. Did you know when you go so out into the world, you're planting seeds? That's called seed time. You don't reap seeds. So the world doesn't understand our language.
You say, well, they're not supposed to, hallelujah, it's holy.
No, but you should be able to communicate. But if you keep saying, I'm reaping you as a harvest, they said, I don't even know who I am as a seed yet. So when we reap them as a harvest and got them saved, how many of you know we don't get anybody saved? God did that, amen? But when we got them saved, we stored them in our barn as seeds and then called it a harvest. Then we ate the seeds by keeping them babies dependent on the leader. Oh, come on, somebody. You know, you're my little sheepy. You're the sheep. Thank God I'm your shepherd. I'm going to keep you dependent on the shepherd because you're dumb sheep. I know we're the sheep of his pasture. Can you say amen? I know that we're always going to be his babies. But you know, when my kids who you saw, when I know they're going to always be our babies, but whenever I show the baby pictures, they're embarrassed. Because they've grown up. How many of you believe kingdom isn't keeping you sheep, but developing saints? To where we begin to understand seed time and harvest. We don't store seed. We don't eat the seeds. We don't call the seeds a harvest. We plant the seeds. Come on, somebody. We plant them in the ground so they can die to that dust and begin to form roots that go down and begin to emerge. In fact, some pastors have even told me before, oh, I'm afraid my sheep are surpassing me. And I said, that's what's supposed to happen. Don't be intimidated because they're outgrowing you. Begin to say they're sons and daughters. Amen? Ah. So what we do is we have little meetings for the seeds called revivals. Oh, help me, Jesus. I'm going from one emotion of how much love I feel to, oh, God, I'm on the edge. Because it's not that I'm against revivals and the part they played in the past. Amen. But I'm telling you, as I believe I'm representing the King when I say this, Doc, I don't think we're looking for the next revival. Because God has advanced us to renovation. His glory, where we were, where that's all we knew, yeah, maybe he accommodated that. But now those revivals should have brought us to a place to where we're saying it's not about just awaking. We better arise. If I just awake and sleep, and stay in bed, the world is not going to be impacted, and truly we are unessential. But when I awake, come on somebody, and I arise and get out of bed and begin to say, watch out, world, the kingdom is coming to you. That's renovation. Can you say amen? That's what we need to do. It's not about bringing people in. It's about going out into all the world and the spheres of influence God's called you as an ambassador to impact the world to where you don't even have to invite them. You can invite them. But you don't have to, because they're going to say, I need to go where you're going, because you're speaking into who I am that I don't even know. We're too much about the church name instead of the kingdom. Due to religion, people sought the glory of miracles. I love miracles, signs, and wonders. How many of you heard Dr. Rick say that? But I'm not following them. They follow us. But they followed those miracles without understanding, without the application of the power, and not seeking first the wisdom and the purpose of what God was revealing. God wants us to go deeper. Can you say amen? He wants us to go higher. He wants us to say, I don't need a miracle to have faith. In fact, miracles don't produce faith. Faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And whenever I walk in faith and not by sight, I'm going to produce something. And the world, I'm telling you, if you just knew, God's actually given me a vision of some of you, and some of you I don't even know, but I could say the entire room, you have not even begun to see what He's going to pour through you. Come on, somebody. It may cause you to transition from some things. Well, the amens died down. So, revival must become renovation. Anybody who's looking for the next revival led by a particular man or woman is missing God. That's over.
We're bringing so-and-so in to have revival. Why? Everybody's dead. We want to reach our city with dead people.
No, we want to get them awake enough to go out and tell somebody to come to the revival. I know this is going to insult some people, but I'm doing it in love, and God says you have to love me anyway. Amen? So the progress of the kingdom cultivation is equipping sheep to become saints that know how to impact the world and become the glory of God. We're waiting on the glory of God. He says, I'm looking right at Him. Wow. Habakkuk says, and this is where we're at. Habakkuk 2:14, for the earth shall be filled. That literally means impregnated. You know why all the shaking's going on? Why all the, you know, the enemy is reacting like he is? Because he's reacting to us. We're not reacting to him. He knows his time is short because he sees us pregnant. Come on, somebody. We're about to open up and begin to impact change into the landscape. He thought maybe he distracted with little virus things, or, and I'm not putting down the fact that it was a real thing to face, but what I'm saying is the false narratives that went with it and the hidden agendas and all those things that try to be concocted. God sits in the heavens. He doesn't laugh at those who suffered, but He laughs at those who think they can outsmart Him. Because now He says, I am just going to pour more glory through my saints. Woohoo! And that's not just a church service. It's not just two-week meetings. That means that we are actually on a daily basis now. When you begin to wake up, you're going to say, I'm on assignment. God's glory is pouring through me, and I can't hold it in any longer. He's taking me places where I never thought I could go. Amen. The earth shall be filled, impregnated, confirmed, and consecrated, and replenished with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord, the kabod, the doxa of the Lord, manifested as the waters cover the sea. And I was looking at the ocean. My wife and I love to go to the ocean on the weekends when we can. And some of you have heard our little videos. We just tease you with the fact we're there and you're not. I mean, we want you to be blessed is what I'm saying. Anyway, we want you to know what you could have if you just, never mind. Anyway, but the Lord showed me when those waves come in, He said, that water's not just sitting on top of the earth. It's saturating down into it. And it's changing the complexion of the earth. God is going to use you in this next time as the glory goes to the next glory in ways you never dreamed possible. Can anybody receive that? You say, well, I'm just a homemaker, I'm just this, I'm just that. That's been your first mistake. You're insulting God. Because when God made you, he didn't make you for you. He made you to impact the world. And that's what we're going to see. Can somebody say amen to that? Glory, we are a prophetic people, citizens called the King's glory. Now, I want to skip to this and just wrap this up. Is anybody receiving anything? Because this is why God gave us the theme, Glory to Glory, the G2 conference. Because guess what? The devil is scared spitless that you're going to realize how important you are in changing the world. This next level of glory is going to even surprise you and me. Wow. Isaiah chapter 60, verses 1 and 2. I'm probably driving them crazy back there, but I'm just skipping over some stuff. I want to obey the Holy Spirit. Isaiah 60, verses 1 and 2. Arise, shine. Notice he didn't say awake, shine. Arise, shine. Can you say this for yourself? For thy light is come, and the glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. The glory of the Lord is risen upon thee. For behold, the darkness, the thick fog shall cover the earth. Does that sound familiar? And gross darkness the people. In other words, people saying, what is going on? Let me tune in CNN or Fox or some other and see what's going on. You just invited the veil. Gross darkness, the people, but the Lord shall arise upon you, and his glory shall be seen upon you. I want to tell you, I'm prophesying again. What affected you with what you just got through will not affect you like that ever again. Come on, somebody. Because you didn't realize it, but through it, you grew into a galvanization of who you are in him. You're going to be surprised that you're stronger than you were before. And you're going to feel like when you speak, your voice goes past the room. In fact, your own voice is going to scare you, Pastor, and everybody. It's going to scare you. You're going to say, Jay, you're going to say, should I pull back the volume a little bit? I feel like I'm shouting at you. And they're going to say, no, but the volume of what you're saying is knocking us out. Because it's not you. Can you say amen? God says, guess what? I eliminated more of you so I could fill you with more of me. And my glory is going to be seen upon you. So he says, and I want to wrap this up this way. In Matthew 6:13, part B, for thine is the kingdom that produces the power, that reveals the glory forever and ever. Amen. Thine is the kingdom, the author, the authority, the government. Come on, somebody. That produces the power, the authorization, the gifts and the ability to function. That brings and releases the glory or the representation of the operation of the revelation of God. Thine is the kingdom. Power with no authorization is illegal. Amen. But thine is the kingdom that is literally the breadth, the length, the depth, and the height of your sphere. You thought you operated in a little circle. Your circle is about to ripple effect. Is anybody receiving this? It's about to ripple effect. And he says, because you have the authorization of the author, thine is the power, according to character, according to stature, according to office, and according to assignment. It is imperative that you recognize that the only reason why you feel heavy right now is not because things are not right. It's because your flesh is trying to refuse the mantle. But once you make a decision, I will not hold back. I will stand up and allow the mantle to click in place. That the glory of the Lord will begin to shine through you. We felt heavy and thought, well, it's because of all that's going on. No, it's because you are transitioning, and that means a greater mantle is clicking into place. It's been there all along at the same place. You're growing into it. And you begin to say, oh, me? No, not me. I don't want to get up behind the pulpit. I don't want to do all that. You don't have to do what anybody else does. You need to do what you've been called to be and do it well. But you need to accept the mantle. Come on, somebody. Well, they don't respect me out there. They don't look at me that way. Are they God? Or is God God? If God said it, that is it. So guess what? His glory is trapped right now because you let the veil of what other people say about you prevent it from coming and excelling. So accept. Come on, somebody, say it with me. Accept the mantle. Say it. Allow it to take place. You say, I'm just not worthy. That's religion. Trying to put a veil over your face. Well, after all, I'm not Moses. No, thank God. You have the greater one inside of you. Come on, somebody. You have a king on the inside of you who's made you a king and a priest. So we have to say, God, no more excuses, sir. I will stand. I will take my place. I will be your ambassador. I will authorize through your authority what you want me to do on the earth. I will go for it. Amen. I will go for it. For thine is the kingdom, the authorization. Thine is the power, the character, the stature that brings and releases the glory. The glory. Everybody say the glory. The glory of God is his manifested presence where everybody can see. Come on, somebody. Now, the Lord is that Spirit, 2 Corinthians 3:17 and 18. The Lord is that Spirit, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is, say it out loud, liberty. But we all, with open face, beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord, are changed into the same image from glory to glory. I tell people, if you don't like me today, see me tomorrow. I'm changing. Actually, I'm not changing. I'm just growing into what he already said I am. But I'm growing through glory. Begin to say, you know what? Not in a cockiness, not in a egotistical way, but begin to say, this is what my king says about me. I'm on assignment. I will not back down. Your purpose is never put on hold. In fact, now the glory of the Lord has been churning inside of you. How many of you felt that? It's been churning on the inside of you. And so this seminar today is about giving you that instruction, but also a release. That's why we're going to commission at the close and say, now go for it. Your household is going to change. Can you say amen? Your family is going to change. I mean, seeing our kids up there, if you knew what they went through, including this one, you would say, oh my God, talk about glory to glory. Come on, somebody. Don't give up on that family member, because guess what? The glory of God is going to get all over them through you. You may have waited a long time. You may have said, I tried and it didn't seem to work. But God said, I've been incubating the seed all this time. Don't call a harvest seed time. And don't call seed time harvest. But I will tell you today, prophetically by the word of God, it is harvest time. Because we no longer try to keep them in a jar as seeds. But we say with the kingdom authority, be planted into the ground, rich soil, go deep with your roots, rise up past where we are, because when you excel past us, we have succeeded. Amen. And now, When you don't, thank God for those who are called to church work. That's part of it. But we're not called to be church members. We're called to be kingdom innovators. So when you go out there, things will happen. Because now, you don't even recognize yourself. Come on, isn't that right? Now, when you were going through that change into the kingdom, Pastor, did you ever have times you're going, I don't even recognize me? Come on, how many of you have ever had that? You're like, oh, and the more I move into kingdom and I offend some people in the religious realm, and I'm a nice guy, what's wrong? Maybe I should shift back a little bit. I don't know. And God says, I want my glory to come through because you are aborting the baby. You've got to let the baby come through. You got to let the greater glory come through because the glory is not for you, it's for others. Your purpose is not for you, it's for others. God says right here, he says that I have not seen, nor ear heard, neither has it entered into the heart of a man. You know what that says to me? You're supposed to say what? Well, since you ask. What that says to me, I'm so excited, for you. What that says to me is, I have not seen. Meaning, we haven't seen it all yet. And the kingdom doesn't come with observation. So, hearing the preaching is not enough. You've got to become the voice of God in you. Preaching just helps stimulate. It just helps to bring you into alignment, but it doesn't do what only God can do. I have not seen, nor ear heard. I have not seen, so just reading scriptures is not enough. Dr. Rick, I read my Bible an hour every day. What's it saying to you? I don't know. But I know God in his heaven sees me reading his word. Ignorant as I can be, knowing one day in the sweet by, I feel like God is even up there saying, will you shut up? Come on. Don't you feel like God has, God, thank God he is merciful. Aren't you glad you're not a grease spot? Because he is long-suffering. Amen? We're saying, God, I'm awaiting on you. And he says, that's funny, I'm waiting on you. Because I've already done it. But even reading scriptures isn't going to get it done. I have not seen, nor ear heard, or preaching, or all the meetings you can go to. Oh, I got it this time. I got it because of what they said. He says, you still haven't seen it all. But they are revealed by his Spirit in you. I'm praying some of you will have your sleep interrupted. You say, don't do that. My sleep is already interrupted. I don't want it interrupted by the devil. Come on, somebody. How many of you ready for visions and dreams again? Come on, amen. How many of you believe greater things are going to be done in the city? Greater things are coming. The greater glory is really being revealed, but it's going to be revealed through you. So I pray that you get restless in the night and God begins to speak to you to where you can't even sleep because you say, I got to get up. I got to write this down. I got to meditate on it because God is saying this to me and I didn't have to call the preacher. I didn't have to read it. I heard it. Because glory, write this down, glory has a frequency. Woo, amen, amen. This means reading is not enough, hearing preaching is not enough to excel in the glory, but it's being open into you, your next level. Father, let's just stand to our feet. Father, right now, in this very first part of this seminar, take us out of this room in the Spirit. Take us into our heavenly places. Come on, somebody. Begin to reveal secrets and mysteries. Lift up your hand if you say, Lord, I welcome. I welcome the greater glory. Can we just give him some glory right now? Who will lift up a praise? Who will begin to say, our God reigns? Hallelujah. Who will say, I will go? I will go. Father, I am your person. I am your man. I am your woman. Hallelujah. Come on, praise him right out loud. Let the praises of God be in their mouth and a sharp two-edged sword be in their hand. Father, right now we allow your greater glory to come through us and reveal to us who we are in you, for we are your glory as your citizens. Father, I thank you for instruction. I thank you for what you're going to say in these next few sessions. Hallelujah. 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 God's saying something right now. Thank you, Father God. Thank you, Lord. Praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. I really feel like somebody just needs to linger a little longer. It's not about getting religious or some kind of response. It's about God speaking into you. Some of you have had, you've had a vision that didn't appear to work out. You may feel like you're well past the age of getting it done. But God says, I've only begun. God is revealing some things even now that he's been dealing with you about letting go of, so that you can see what he's saying. Hallelujah. Right now where you're at, just begin to thank him and let him know, Father God, I receive this. Hallelujah. 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 Change from glory to glory. God says, I've had you in a G2 seminar. And I have you there because it's ordained of me, that I might reveal myself to you beyond even the glory you thought was glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Whew. Well, hallelujah. You may be seated. Anybody, I feel like somebody might want to ask a question or a comment here. We're just going to let the Lord do this. Anybody get anything out of this today? Amen. And we got more to come, but anybody got a question or a comment? This is interactive. This is what this is about. Yes, in the back. The what? Oh. We can turn this part off because we don't have mics.